Greetings, fellow nerds. In this video, we're going to explore and use a Dean Stark trap, as well as construct a more versatile makeshift version. So first, a bit of background. I've discussed in previous videos the concepts of fractional distillation and in particular the concepts of azeotropes, mixtures of liquids that boil together and behave as single liquids that have a constant composition and boiling point. So far I've been focusing on azeotropes made of homogeneous mixtures of miscible liquids, but another very interesting class is azeotropes consisting of immiscible liquids. Here I have a mixture of toluene and water. Toluene boils at 110 Celsius and water obviously boils at 100 Celsius. They don't mix very much at room temperature, but if you set up a distillation and boil them over, an interesting thing happens. They form an azeotrope that boils together at a much lower temperature of 84 degrees Celsius. When they condense and cool, they separate back into their separate phases. This is extremely useful and we can exploit this for such applications as removing most of the water from an organic sample. Just boil it out, pour the organic layer back into the boiling flask while separating the water and boil it out again. Now you might ask why we don't simply use a separatory funnel, and while this is certainly the way to go if the mixtures are simple and easy to separate, sometimes you have to deal with complicated sludges, tars, emulsions, viscous gels, and other heterogeneous mixtures. A separatory funnel isn't going to do much if the components just don't separate. Adding an easy to boil carrier solvent like toluene lets you boil out the water and separate it that way. Now a very difficult sample might take hours or even days of refluxing and returning the organic layer to get good separation. So two chemists, E.W. Dean and D.D. Stark, ran into the same labor problem when they wanted to analyze the water content of petroleum samples. To solve this, they invented the Dean-Stark apparatus. Other devices under different names that essentially do the same thing include the Dean-Stark receiver, the Barrett trap, and the Clevenger trap. What I have in my hand here is technically a Barrett trap because it has a stopcock for draining the water out as it accumulates. The original Dean-Stark trap has just a blind tube for measuring the water accumulated, but the name Dean-Stark trap has become so commonplace for these devices that I'm going to call it a Dean-Stark trap as well for this video. Now how this works is that you attach this to the top of the boiling flask and as the vapors rise into the trap, they condense on a condenser attached to the top. The liquid falls into the trap and the denser phase, usually water, accumulates in the bottom. The lighter phase fills up the trap and eventually overflows back into the boiling flask, replenishing it, allowing more of the azeotrope to be boiled out. If too much of the heavy phase accumulates, then it will also overflow back, so it can be removed using this stopcock here. Okay, let's see this thing in action. Here I've set up a boiling flask containing a mixture of water and toluene. And up here is the condenser. It's all extremely simple to use and set up. Now all we have to do is turn on the heating. And there it goes. The azeotrope of water and toluene is rising up into the trap and condensing in the condenser, where it then falls into the trap. You can already see the layer of denser water accumulating in the bottom of the trap. Eventually, when the distillate reaches the top, it will overflow and the lighter phase will return to the boiling flask. Now removing and measuring the water from a difficult sample isn't the only use for a Dean-Stark trap. It can also be used to remove water from reactions. For example, if you're making esters with very high boiling alcohols and acids, the water will most likely form an azeotrope with one of the reagents or products, and you can remove it with a Dean-Stark trap. The trap then returns the reagent to continue the reaction. Let me flip over this clamp so you can see the overflow. Anyway, as I was saying before, you can use the trap to remove water from samples as well as reactions. You can see that the process of separating the two phases and returning the lighter phase requires almost no user interaction. So for extremely slow or difficult samples and reactions, you can just set up and walk away to spend your valuable time elsewhere. The only time you do need to interact with the apparatus during the operation is if there's so much of the heavier phase that it starts overflowing and you need to empty the trap. So you usually select a large enough trap that you need to do this as few times as possible, if at all. Okay, we've been running this for some time now and the water layer seems to have stopped growing. We've pretty much removed all the water we can by this method. If you're doing analytical work like Dean and Stark were, then you can just read off the amount collected on the graduations. Alternatively, you can remove the water from the trap by using it like a separatory funnel. And there we go. And here is the toluene after cooling without any visible water content. And here is the water that was originally added. This method is a very cheap way of removing water from immiscible solvents and excellent for pre-drying solvents before using much more expensive chemical drying techniques, allowing you to use less chemicals overall. Now I've seen Dean-Stark traps cost anywhere from $20 to several hundred dollars depending on the size, the quality, and extra features like vacuum jackets or the ability to return the heavier phase rather than the lighter phase. So you have to select the one that suits your needs. This one here was generously donated to me, but if I had to purchase this exact model, it would have cost me around $250 from the original manufacturer. So once again, to the individual that donated this, thank you very much. I would never have bought one myself. Now if you use one very often in your work, then it's worth getting a professional unit. But if you rarely need one, then a very crude unit can be constructed from more common glassware. And here it is. I know it's a little bit daunting and far more unwieldy than a professional unit, but it does the job and it can be put together in 10 minutes. Let me walk you through it. Down here is our boiling flask containing our water and toluene test sample. Above that we have a Claisen adapter, but you can use a cheaper gas inlet adapter if you have one. Now to the Claisen adapter we have a condenser column. This is not actually being used as a condenser, as you can see it's unconnected and you can use just with any column. What we want here is to increase the height of the still head up here. So you can use whatever column you want to achieve that. Now to the still head we have a properly connected condenser column that will actually be used as a condenser. At the end we have our distillation adapter, although this is optional if you tilt the graduated cylinder down here. Now key to the whole operation is this tube that siphons out liquids in the graduated cylinder and sends them to this hose adapter that connects to the Claisen adapter and returns liquids to the boiling flask. Now because this system is dependent on siphon action to work, it must be properly aligned and pre-filled before you start, unlike a professional trap that can run empty. First, make sure the inlet of the siphon tube is below the outlet relative to gravity. Second, the lowest point in between the two ports must be lower than the bottom of the graduated cylinder, so going by the shortest distance is not allowed. Setting it up like this ensures the siphon will always work and withdraw fluid from the graduated cylinder, without over-emptying it and sucking in air that stops the siphon and causing it to overflow later. Now you need to pre-fill the tube and graduated cylinder with the carrier fluid. Since we want to collect water, our carrier fluid is toluene. I'm filling through the hose adapter here, but you can use whatever method you want. Fill up the graduated cylinder until it's past the tube inlet. Now make sure the tube itself is filled without air bubbles in the top. You may have to move around the tube somewhat to work the bubbles out. Once the siphon is achieved, if you move around the hose adapter filled with liquid, the level will match the cylinder as the siphon maintains balance. At this point, reinstall the hose adapter onto the Claisen adapter. It's alright if some air now appears in this end of the tube. The lower midpoint of the tube should prevent it from creeping up to the highest point. It's vitally important that air never gets into this highest point or the siphon will be broken. As one final test, try to overfill the graduated cylinder with carrier fluid. If everything is set up correctly, then the excess fluid will get siphoned out and ejected out the outlet port where it will return to the boiling flask. You can now adjust the inlet port higher if you wish, as long as it's always below the top of the fluid and the outlet port. Give a centimeter or so of margin just in case dripping fluid from the condenser brings down some air bubbles. Oh yeah, this black clip up here secures the tube so it doesn't change its position while the distillation is running. Always have some way to secure your tube. Now that everything is set up, turn on the heating and we can now watch our homemade Dean Stark trap in action. And there it goes. First the vapor rises up through the columns and into the condenser. It condenses back into a liquid that phase separates and drips into the graduated cylinder. The heavier water phase sinks to the bottom where it collects. The lighter phase overfills the cylinder and the siphon tube sucks it out and returns it to the boiling flask with the Claisen adapter. Completely self-running and requiring no user intervention, unless it's for emptying the graduated cylinder. Now the whole thing costs about $150 or about the price of a moderately expensive Dean Stark trap. But since the components are more commonly used for other experiments, chances are a well-stocked laboratory already has most if not all of them. The total effective cost can be considerably reduced. Now obviously if you're going to do this a lot, it might be more effective to spend the money on a complete Dean Stark trap so you can use your glassware elsewhere. For one, this is a hell of a lot nicer looking. Anyway, looks like all the water has been collected and now it's just cycling carrier fluid. Now so far I've just demonstrated light return Dean Stark traps that just return the lighter phase. But what if we want to do the opposite? What if we want to return the heavier phase and keep the light phase? This is especially important for herbalists, botanists, and other scientists that collect oils and chemicals from natural sources. They use steam distillation where boiling water carries the oils out in the steam. This professional Dean Stark trap only returns the lighter phase and cannot be easily modified to return the heavier phase. We could purchase a trap specifically for return heavier phases, but those are even rare and more expensive. Fortunately, our homemade unit can be easily modified for heavy return. So I've emptied out the cylinder and tube, and just like with the light return mode, we make sure all the tube positions are where they should be, and we fill this time with water since that is our carrier fluid, and our target is the lighter oil. Once everything is set up, we just perform one simple change to convert this apparatus to heavy return mode. We push the siphon tube in the graduated cylinder all the way to the bottom. And that's it. Let me turn on the heating. Now when the distillate pours into the graduated cylinder, the siphon tube sucks out the heavy layer and returns that. The lighter layer has nowhere to go and thus accumulates in the graduated cylinder. Heavy distillate will sink through the lighter layer and accumulate in the bottom where it can be siphoned out again. So our homemade apparatus, despite being big, slow, and ugly, can easily be converted to both light return and heavy return modes. A professional unit that can be converted to both modes is extremely rare and somewhat pricey. I don't do nearly enough distillation work to justify buying it. So there you have it, the Dean Stark apparatus and how to make it.
If you would like to support the continued production of science videos like this one, please support the channel on Patreon. Links are in the video description.